As we know how carbon dioxide dominates our climate, there has never more been a more suitable time to receive lessons from our neighbors. We are working to solve this excellent atmosphere, overly complex weather patterns, but with the latest data from Venus Express, we are studying by mapping out in three dimensions how the environment behaves. Unprotected by a magnetic shield, Venus is still being stripped of valuable water. Venus Express has seen how the solar wind erodes in the atmosphere. You can observe that even now, that water is still emerging as oxygen and hydrogen. Furthermore, that is an implication that there has been more jumpiness in the past. Despite all this practical application, we still do not comprehend what triggered Venus's diabolical conversion. People argue over whether Venus ever had a satellite. If Venus had a moon at one point, could that moon have ultimately affected the surface, caused some accident to occur? We do not know. It could have probably held a constituent. Perhaps such an impression explains both the unfamiliar calendar and weather on Venus. Was it hit solid enough to flip upside down, and for its time to be slowed to a crawl? Was this the second Venus's climate was thrust into chaos? Whatever the condition of Venus's climate catastrophe, could life have ever endured such an ordeal? If I had to guess or had to bet, I would say, yeah. The Institute of Life, and I would say that because we know about life on Earth, is that it began early and did not appear to have required any unusual conditions. If there was a growth of our kind, the organic kind, on the exterior of Venus a long time ago, then what transpired to that life? One possibility is that it simply died out. But there is another event that is a little more exotic, which may have transferred up into the clouds. Some think Venus might still harbor life, even though it is such an unfriendly place. Moreover, the thought is that, well, gee, at one time, Venus was like the Earth in the opening 2 billion years of its history. So if consciousness were to grab a hold, perhaps life could linger ahead of the environmental catastrophe that befell Venus as the water abandoned the planet. Could life survive in the clouds of Venus? The most reliable method to know for sure is to drift into the atmosphere and discover why. Mercury and Venus, the weirdest planets of all. Everyone likes a holiday in a warm climate, but how about a voyage to two planets that act as hot as hell if you were stepping on the exterior of Mercury? You would need one heck of a spacesuit. Perplexing, Mercury appears inert and abandoned, but buried deep inside is a clue to a complex past. The minor planet created out of the densest material, including the most lunar-like scenery at its surface and producing the magnetic field. It is a planet that is part boiler, part freezer. Finally, you get to the greater ranges on Mercury. The ice is held in places where the sun never more glows. It is nearby Venus, goddess of love, who will soften your heart and break your defenses concurrently. So that is how real how. Once the double of Earth, something ran wrong here, remarkably wrong. At some point, Venus possessed an ocean's worth of water that is presently gone. What changed Venus from heaven to a pressure cooker? I like to practice the term alien Venus. I think Venus is the most different planet we have. Could this be our fate? The Earth's destination looks similar to how Venus seems today, and here on our doorstep, there is perhaps the most incredible survival story of all. Some thought that Venus might still shelter life, even though it is such an unfriendly place. There has never existed a more suitable time to go wherever no human has operated before boldly. To follow in the tracks of our robot explorers, furthermore visit the planetoids of our solar system, looks proper for launch into. No man ever desired to be an astronaut. Imagine it was you traveling to the hot zone of the two inner planets. Where would you go? What would you perceive? And how would you endure? The most advanced robotic missions have shared more about these environments than ever previously. Armed with this original knowledge, think of this as your Voyager guide to our related neighbors. Right now, as the planet nearest to the sun, Mercury is the ultimate summer holiday. Step out of your spacecraft and sizzling warmth is assured for a day that lasts 3 months. Furthermore, when the sun ultimately does not set the night, life starts with a bizarre cosmic light display. This is one pockmarked planetoid worth taking a closer look at. Like our moon, Mercury is masked in craters. More and more, you know you cannot stare at the moon or Mercury without viewing impact cavities. What is inspiring for me is that I get to be one of the first people to see these pictures of, you know, places on the planet that we have never observed before. Most people come here to Meteor Crater in Arizona to see a massive hole in the ground. If you want to analyze collision craters on Mercury, this is the best spot to reach. I mean, this is the question well-preserved collision crater on Earth. It is nearest you are going to make it. Question whatever it would be like to catch a scroll on Mercury. You can roam around a meteorite crater in approximately an hour, but on Mercury, you would not comprehend when to finish. Craters here range as far as the eye can see. If you are lying on a crater on Mercury, this crater would be a relatively young one, and you would likewise have craters on top of such one. You would have cavities down. I mean, also simply the little rocks here would have tinier craters on them, and then, you know, you would presumably be inside an immense, colossal crater too, that you would not even be capable of recognizing. All of us are here later to curb over. Although no human has ever set foot on Mercury, we have a fairly good idea of what you would see. We got to get under and go. If you were wandering around on the exterior of Mercury, it would resemble a lot like the when you walk onto Mercury, you move into a world with no actual atmosphere, where the sky is as black as midnight and burning in the sunshine. Furthermore, a drive is an off-road trek by at least a 3 billion-year-old battlefront. Enormous craters, shallow craters, craters throughout. So that is your initial hypothesis. Mercury caught most of its battering early on, as the moon, a silent observer to the dawn of time. It has been uninterrupted by a single drop of rainfall or puff of wind ever following. Mostly, the exterior of Mercury has been fixed in time for points of billions of years, and you may state that is boring, but unnecessary if it is a good thing because these planets, such as Mercury in the moon, conserve a history of what was going through this critical early phase of the solar system's development. Thus, we can analyze it yonder, because it is lying directly on the exterior. As a result, each rock and pit of this pockmarked world has the potential to stare back 4.5 billion years. Calculating these craters is just the primary challenge to unveiling a similar planet to Mercury. It is constantly low on the boundary, so it is hard to aim a telescope from Earth. Furthermore, it is hard to revolve around Mercury because it is so tight to the Sun. For that purpose, Mercury continues to be one of the most underexplored planets in our solar system. Like its geological past, many characters are an enigma, but some things we do know. This lonely planet has a newfangled sense of keeping time. Once you land, you will reset your watch for a time zone like no other. It has such an eccentric orbit and revolution period, the days and nights are unusual. Mercury in the air is only 88 Earth days long. Thanks to its quick dash around the sun, it revolves so slowly that a single day takes much longer. The day on Mercury is about a half a year on Earth terms. Although associated with us since classical times, we have a limited idea of what the planet resembled for thousands of years. Then in 1974, NASA's Mariner 10 transfers back into the first ever glimpses of its surface images that can be transferred to tracking stations and onto the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in California due to Mercury's crawling revolution and its elliptical orbit around the Sun. When it shuttled by three times, it saw the identical half of the planet, so we have only examined something like 45% of the planet at moderately low resolution. Stored in these obscure black and white postcards for above 30 years are signs that feature to one of Mercury's most giant puzzles. It has been contracting. Mercury does not have plate tectonics such as the Earth produces, so we know that Mercury's crust is supporting much concentration. Furthermore, the single way you can achieve that is if the planet track, as Mariner 10 flies past, the mystery intensifies. The spacecraft discovers an enormous iron core hidden inside. Thus, you can consider it as a significantly shriveling planet. Mercury's center makes up about 60% of the planet's biomass. It is nearly twice as large as Earth's. Why would it have such a big core for such a minor planet? Some people hold a tremendous collision. I shredded off a lot of the planetoid, and momentarily, we see the remains of a formerly major giant planet. What is left is a planet's capacity for iron. Many inquiries about Mercury endure unsettled, questions a new mission will conceivably solve. NASA's Messenger shuttle will become the leading probe to orbit Mercury. Getting a spacecraft into orbit around Mercury is doubtful for two ends, the Sun and the Sun. The Sun causes heat, and the Sun is a source of gravity. To creep beyond the Sun, Messenger takes a convoluted path, flying past the Earth once, Venus twice, and Mercury itself three times, to enter full-time orbit by 2011. If you get into orbit, you can complete mapping the entire planet at sensibly high resolution, so we will begin having a mature and significant knowledge of Mercury, not only at the surface, but its physical chemistry throughout the full planet. From that, we can explain to some extent how it developed. What other mysteries are etched into Mercury's aged surface already? Messenger has sent after some curious evidence. Miners more than landing at Mercury, a list of absolute miracles to see, and a dazzling light show. Left on, after runners' three flybys, we have now outlined over 90% of the planetoid apprehended from around 124 miles. These pictures are the most open to date of Mercury. Furthermore, it is easy to spot a cavity of epic relationships, the effect of still another titanic impact. That is the color space and this contact basin, and it comprises nearly 3 million square kilometers. It is one of the largest in the solar system, the dimensions of Alaska and California connected. Whatever produced Chloris nearly wrecked the planet. It was something in the order of 100 kilometers in size. It could have held an enormous comet or an extensive asteroid. Instead, it has a catastrophic influence on the surface. Shockwaves waved around the crust, buckling it onto the opposite side. Furthermore, near the crater's middle is an extra thrilling geological mystery, with experts scratching their heads. The spider is this unusual feature around the center of the Chloris Basin, of a spider that bothers me when I catch people call it because it does not look related to a spider. How many legs does a spider possess? 8, right? It resembles 100-legged spiders, but it possesses these radiating fractures coming out of it. Whether the spider is the effect of planetary stretch marks or some mysterious cratering method, no one understands. It is an exciting feature, and we do not understand what form. It is pretty tantalite. Mercury glistens as a cemetery of past astronomical encounters, but is it as lifeless as it appears? A wise traveler would step with discretion. When we gaze at the surface, there are all these cavities, and they are identical structures. Thus, when we observe a crater that resembles this one here, it does not possess an elevated rim. It has unevenly shaped. That is always impressive, because those are volcanic apertures. Thus, this is the site of sensitive volcanism that's occurred. It was not just, you know, lava streaming out. It was certainly firefighting events too. we resolved a 30-year-old debate about the geological development of the planet originating from a question that Mariner 10 established, but did not solve. And that is how vital volcanism has been on the history of that planet. So for a planet that seems inactive, more has been working on deep inside Mercury than we ever gave it account for. There is even more happening above the surface that cannot be comprehended, and it includes the ruthless force of the Sun. Like Mercury, the Earth takes a thrashing from the Sun's violent ire. Flares, sunstorms, and other solar hissy fits can cause electronic deformation for the satellites that traverse above our heads. Fortunately, the Earth is shielded from this radiation by a magnetic buffer, a kind of force field produced by our molten iron core. Planetary magnetic fields shield planets, their exteriors, and their environments from energized particles that are continuously coming from the Sun. The auroras that illuminate our polar skies are a testimony of our guarding shield at practice. Without it, life would not survive here. Visit Mercury, and you will attend the only different planet in the inner solar system including a magnetic field. Now the puzzle there is that to hold a magnetic field, you need to have an inside to the planet that is at least somewhat molten Mercury. One of the smallest of the planets would have been required to have chilled all the way through. Its very continuation defies interpretation. The purpose you desire to go to Mercury as a voyage target would be this nice side view, because it will be highly unusual in the solar system. We have a moderately strong, very distinct magnetic field with an origin found deep in the planet. Whatever tool drives Mercury's magnetic field, it is too vulnerable to defend from the Sun's full force, the solar wind, and buffet Mercury's tenuous atmosphere. Furthermore, in the method, it puts on a radiant show. You hold sodium, that is, atoms that are flowing off and delivering this yellow light, so you could essentially look like you are standing in a donut of sodium discharge. With the morning 3 months away, you will have loads of time to sit back and take in the picture framed in a radiance of amber light. You could get a rather excellent light display in some function, and I know people go to Canada to study the Northern Lights all the time. Thus, that would be the motivation to go to Mercury, not a night owl and then travel into daylight. If you require a suntan, you cannot beat the dirty powers of Mercury. Stretch out on the sand here, and the Sun crackles and fishes right over you, emerging almost 3 times more noticeable in the sky and 7 times as warm. If you were strolling on the surface of Mercury, you require one heck of a spacesuit, because if you stayed in the Sun, it would swelter. You would see an immense sun in the sky that would just, you know, cooked to death if you spent any long terms in it. The Mercury rises Mercury to a toasty 840 degrees Fahrenheit. That is about twice as warm as your kitchen oven on full power. At such large temperatures, you have a place where you may have ponds of liquid metals, and you would absolutely not want to step in them. You can always head to the dark side to avoid the temperature, but dress cordially with essentially no atmosphere to keep the heat. The temperature plunges to minus 275 degrees. Furthermore, it is here in the freezer that Messenger will face another puzzle. Can ice subsist on a planet so near to the Sun? Only during the first radar investigations of the exterior of Mercury were taken back in the 90s was it found that Mercury had what seemed to be polar caps in these initial radar images. Some corners of Mercury's polar cavities are in eternal shadow here on the most sun-baked planet of all. Water appears to survive, frozen in constant darkness. The ice is carried in places where the sun never illuminates. Thus, the ice is collected in these dark depths of craters at the high latitude areas. We found the same information on our moon in late 2020, and the L-Cross mission dropped a probe into a deeply shaded crater, confirming ice buried near the lunar south pole. Where did it come from? A comet? It is captivating, because we believe that the water in the Earth and its environment in the oceans is still below the exterior, probably came from a related source. Thus, part of the story of Mercury is to find out whatever the water came from, and perhaps that might help us locate where the water on Earth originated from. It may never more be conceived to send a human to Mercury, but how concerning a robot? In 2021, when MESSENGER appeared in orbit, imagine this tiny firm spacecraft orbiting a remote planet a very significant way from home. Move away from the Sun, and you would assume things to chill down a fraction. Venus, the image of coolness and quiet, all colorless, beguiling, cloaked by clouds, but the planet of love is shrouded in irregularity. Underneath the clouds are the solitary planet in the solar system to revolve backward, and it appears so very gradually. If you could comprehend it, the Sun rises in the west and sets in the east a full day here, lasts for 8 Earth months, which is greater than the Venusian year. Venus, you can stroll around the planet quicker than the planet revolves. The sky overhead is as heavy as it seems, packed with CO2. Venus's cloud covering is primarily made of carbon dioxide from the Earth. We have the same amount, but it has been tied up in rocks like mine. Stones are drawn up in reefs on Venus. All that carbon dioxide is in the atmosphere. It is the difference among worlds that are so interesting. This is because 4.5 billion years ago, Venus and Earth began as terrestrial doubles. They were developed right alongside to each other. They are familiar to each other in the solar system. They have comparable dimensions. Not only this, but we also now understand that the planets were transferring material early on. Bits of Earth were settling on Venus, and bits of Venus were dropping in on Earth. So if living already started on any of these worlds, it might well have developed among them in these small flakes getting hit off from all the collisions happening then, all the other big clashes. You are beyond on the most interesting, nerve-shattering journey in the history of man. 50 years ago, it was easy for us to dream of Venus closer to the Sun and shrouded in clouds to be searched our scorched tropic system teeming with life. This image of Venus is a sort of archaic, steamy Earth, complete with enormous tree ferns and dinosaurs. Collectively, it looked to us like it should just be perhaps even populated. In the late 50s, the space race starts while America points to the moon. Settling on Venus proved difficult. One by one, the Soviet Venera probes pass within the thick Venusian atmosphere. Their last broadcasts were advising of a world of inconceivably high temperatures and pressure. Nevertheless, tenacity and challenging Russian design ultimately pay off in 1975. The camera on the redesigned Venier and 9 eventually enter the Venetian Veil. What it perceives is nothing similar to the tropical utopia envisioned. This is the first ever picture taken from the surface of a different planet. Furthermore, that is the earliest time it was delivered. Black and white scenes of the dinosaurs. These pictures were necessary because it is the earliest time we human beings got a chance to see. One of the most entertaining things about Venus is that we understand that it had a sentiment like the one we had here on Earth in Venus's history. There have been elements measured in the environment that show you that at some period, Venus possessed an ocean's worth of liquid that is now gone. Atlantis, Houston, everything below here seems reasonable to us. So wherever did all the water on Venus go? And what else rests hidden under her veil? In 1989, the space shuttle Atlantis launched the Magellan probe near Venus. Roger all. After 15 months, Magellan used radiolocation eyes to gaze through the vapors from orbit. When you have that knowledge to pick an image and say, I am one of the initial 3 people, I am one of the initial 5 people to ever look at this section of ground on another planet, it is such a feeling of awe and a sense of innovation. Magellan's radar removes the dense clouds for the first time, and we comprehend all of Venus laid bare. Embrace to Lavalier. There are volcanoes of all measurements, from a kilometer transverse to hundreds of kilometers across. Furthermore, for that reason, it is not all that different from some areas on Earth. Nevertheless, on the other hand, in this barren world with no nature at all, it is the absolute number of volcanoes that begins Venus apart. This is a world that has been wounded by fire. Over 600 enormous volcanoes penetrate its surface. Some may, however, be working. You can recognize from this spheroid of Venus, which comprises the Magellan imagery hung over the globe, and then the tones tell you how high the surfaces are. So the dark blues are low ranges and the lighter colors are higher is one of my preferences is up here in Ishtar Terra, where we possess a continent-sized territory. So think of something sort of on the scale of Africa or Australia. Furthermore, I question if Ishtar, somehow the remains of a past event of plate tectonics, is not early in Venus's history. Just an attempt like this would probably seem a lot like a Mark Bullock likes wasting time on Venus, at least the variant he finds here on Earth. Hawaii has some of the most striking volcanoes, similar to the volcanoes that we observe on Venus. The vast, lightly sloped volcanoes of Hawaii may move on Venus. There are at least 150 extending from this size to 10 times greater. The discerning visitor may remark that Venus is craving something. The whole impact crater position on Venus is very perplexing. With the Magellan pictures, we see a tiny amount of impact craters. Furthermore, wherein 1,000 is such a minute number because we understand how impactors become in. We can date the exterior to somewhere along 300 million and 1 billion years old. Someday in the modern geological past, it appears the entire surface of Venus was changed and swiftly. The surface geology of Venus is separate from the Earth, basically because of the shortage of water. Water is not lubricating that covering, so you do not get plate tectonics, rather. What shows to follow is that forces inside the planetoid attempt to move things around, but they cannot. It has bolted, and then it erupts. Pervasive, globally explosive events happen about every 500 million to 2 billion years. So you would not require to be on Venus when that occurs because once something opens the way, the entire planet might erupt and set itself over in a short amount of time in geological cycles. So this is an example of the big secrets of Venus and something that we need to find out. In recent years, obtaining the source of Venus is thick. The atmosphere has grown crucial for all of us down here on Earth. 500,000 tons of sulfur dioxide blew into the atmosphere each year. No one on Earth would like our world to stink. Like Venus, we favor oxygen to acid and poison. You can detect the sulfur probably when Venus would smell like we could fly over it, and we absolutely would not like to breathe in an enormous pressure cooker set on high. You would not aspire to live on Venus, period. Venus is what you get when the greenhouse influence goes wrong. The entire greenhouse effect was not identified as a significant effect to control planetary climates until we traveled to Venus and determined that instead of being 90 degrees Fahrenheit, it was 900 degrees Fahrenheit. Furthermore, we said, wait, what is wrong with this is gained about this. Furthermore, it showed us about the greenhouse on the greenhouse. Ever questioned how alien a planet could be? How bad a weather can get? Try the planet next door. The best way to encounter satisfaction is to hitch a fabulous ride on a Soviet veneer method. Well, it would be a wild ride. The clouds rise up about 40 miles up, an unusual 5 times higher than the Earth's what we are produced out of. They are not created out of the water, and they may not have a different body made of sulfuric acid. Everywhere you go, they are working on trying to eat you away. As you go farther, things heat up. The thickening air allows the sun's heat in, but not out. It is also becoming dense. So compact, your probe drops like a coin in one. As we fell, we would gradually surface, constantly appearing to us as if we were nearing the bottom of the sea. Congratulations, you have landed on the warmest part in the solar system here. The official warmth is 870 degrees Fahrenheit. Day or night, equator or pole, the scoring heat never alters more than a few points, and it is why we possess so few pictures from the Venusian surface. So why is it so challenging to bring scientific devices to the surface of Venus? What about an average camera? There's plenty of daylight there. Why not simply send a camera and take photographs? I have got my NASA-issued spacesuit here, my personal Venus suit. Furthermore, let us take this camera and give it to Venus and perceive what issues. Primarily, you do not aspire to meet. It is such a tropical climate that all electronics, power, and communications must be solid. That is about anything automatic. Anything electronic is just an immense challenge to have a functioning covering. I think it would be rather like what might conceive of as how, you know, we would see heat waves and challenges in the atmosphere. If this was Venus, what would be changed? Well, we would not be here because we molt in small puddles of human beings. Furthermore, it is not the only energy you must bear. All that air above is heavy, squeezing at around 90 times the force on Earth. When I was a graduate student, I discussed what would get you first, the temperature or the stress. It would be pretty contemporary, I think. To penetrate to the surface of Venus is the same as diving over half a mile under sea. Tremendous pressure, enormous crushing force. How do you make something that withstands how things turn and move beneath? Those are valuable outside pressures. The automotive technology is all about exosuit, using composite fiber and durable aluminum alloys and stainless steel, titanium and all those things. It resembles something out of Transformers, or left out of a comic book. That's the identical suit that would require you to be on the exterior of Venus. You would never suspect the threats on the ground from orbit, except maybe for this extensive double-barreled storm hovering beyond these poles. We call dipole characteristics twirling around. We do not really understand what they are, but the complete feature itself, indeed 1,000 or 2 kilometers across, is not significant. It has a form, a type of expression to it. Believed to be formed by winds that roar throughout the equator at rates of 230 miles per hour, these typhoons can divide into 3, and indeed 4. Furthermore, the turbulent weather does not finish because the warmest planet in the solar system even has snow, but not as we know it. Suddenly, in the radar images, all the hills go white. Now that is because there is no profoundly reflective coating. It would not resemble white to your eyes if you could settle on the surface of Venus. Instead, it might seem shiny because we believe it might be some metallic film, almost like a pirate or a fool's gold. So something sparkly, which to me is even more helpful than staring at the snow. These are simply some problems that the European Space Agency's Venus Express, presently in orbit, wishes to solve.